We know that love sometimes takes us into a point of risk where we're going to have to step out. And I'd like you to think about this little introduction here. A man happened along, three bricklayers busy at work. He asked the first bricklayer, "What are you doing?" "I'm laying bricks," the first bricklayer said. The man asked the second bricklayer the same question. "I'm putting up a wall," was the reply. The passerby then posed the question to the third bricklayer. "What are you doing?" he asked. "I'm building a great cathedral to the glory of God." You know, the why of life matters. God wants us to know why we're up and doing things, and so that we can find the full purpose in life. God wants you to know this: how to get up each morning and be inspired by the why of life, and that is who God is. There's a new bestseller book out, and it's called Start With Why. And just like the bricklayers here, you can be doing a task, but why you're doing it matters. I wish I'd known this when I was a housewife at home and washing all those dishes and doing laundry and just remembering you're not just doing mundane things, but you're doing them for the glory of God, that hopefully you're going to raise your children to be Christians, that will be in the world giving out light. I can remember thinking, seriously thinking this when I was in college. I'd see some, if you go to Ohio State University, you're nearby campus there, you get a street or so away from campus and you are really into some bad areas, you know. And so I thought to myself, I like to help people, but when I'm not here, I hope I have children that will be helping somebody else too. And so we have this call by God to teach each person, especially the next generation, the whys of life. But here's the whys that we need to think of. And so when you get up in the morning, you can wake up feeling inspired. Now, this generally doesn't happen a lot. I mean, a lot of times we wake up, we're still pretty tired. But I want to help you think about beyond the physical of maybe still needing more sleep, how you can wake up and actually feel inspired about your day, no matter what God is, what kind of work or anything God's called you to. The first thing to do is to get up and remember who God is. And take a minute to think about just the characteristics of God, that God's the glorious light. The glorious light. And when we shine the light on the kids' heads, we don't always get to see that big bright light breaking through. But you know, it breaks through in little ways. It breaks through in little acts of kindness. It breaks through when these kids or when you as a Christian do the right thing. Instead of adding to the evil to the world, we're adding to the good. We think about God, we get inspired that He's all that is good. When we think about God, we can be inspired when we think about peace, that He wants peace for people's lives and for our world. Now, before I was a pastor, I was a social worker. And I found a lot more hope in the church than I even do in social work, because it seemed like I was what I would call always coming behind and cleaning up the mess that had already happened. But I thought, wouldn't it be great if we could teach people ahead the good stuff? If we could teach them ahead about the Lord. I had people that would call all the time. I worked for a children's services. And they would do what I would call create a crisis. You know? And this is how you can create a crisis, not that you want to do it, but it's how you respond to life. Okay? So they have, so we all have this dysfunction in our families. Even in the Bible, we talked about the dysfunctional family. So somebody, their sister-in-law or somebody calls them up and just gives them what for. Calls them up, and they said, and I had to respond this way, and then that escalated that, then I got mad, and then I hit the kid, it went from there. No, we didn't have to respond that way. You know, when you have the Holy Spirit, you can be a peacemaker. And no matter what somebody else does, you don't have to respond anyway. You can respond a godly way. Even if the most godly way is to hang up the phone and not say anything. But you don't have to be into that crisis. You don't have to be part of it. You can be a peacemaker. Think about God, about how much He loves peace. Think about God's loving kindness. I told you that a few weeks ago I went with Sands Elementary. They had a study of the different world religions. And I thought it'd be interesting too, so I went down and got my fingerprinted. I'm proud to say I passed. and I could be a chaperone to go on their field trip. And we went and saw the Hindu temple, the mosque, the synagogue, and then they had come here for the Christian. You know, I don't notice any other God that starts like this. If you know John 3:16, for God so loved the world. What's God about? For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever, open to anybody, whoever believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. God loving and God giving. There's no God like ours. So spend a few moments each morning thinking about the loving God that we have. And if the world could get a hold of that. And think about the hope that life has meaning when lived God's way. Now this is another thing that happens with people, and I've been guilty of it too, being mad at God. Just admit it if you've ever been mad at God. I mean, every Christian even should raise their hand. There's been times we don't like it. We don't like what's happened, or sometimes we might have created some of that by some of our decisions along the way. And sometimes life just happens. But I know at my last church we had the ecumenical charities, and that's when all the churches in town pooled their money together, and on the food pantry day, if somebody was short on rent or whatever, they could come and talk to the different ministers and say, you know, ask for what they needed help with. And people would often tell of their stories and how things were going bad in their life, and things can go bad at any point. But some of the times of going bad is like this. We want God to protect us, but we don't want to do things God's way. And if we do like that, it would be like saying, I want someone to protect me, but I'm going to cross a busy street blindfolded. You know, if we go through life and just sort of try to figure it out for ourselves, that's not going to work. But to think, I just want you to say each morning, if I can just think of who God is. And what we want God to provide and protect, but we need to be in His plan. Okay, don't ask God to protect you as you find your way in life on your own without following God's commands. He can protect and provide if we will follow His ways. If we want to go out and do our own thing, not to say He won't rescue us, but it's just not the way that God can provide the best for us. One way that just to do this in the morning is, if you're a person who likes music, then you can sing a couple of hymns to God. Or if you say, I don't sing, turn on the YouTube and pull up a couple of songs, 10,000 Reasons or one of these here, and remember who God is. I mean, if you start out in the morning and think, I'm dreading this day, I want you to get on YouTube and pull up that song, 10,000 Reasons. And that will give you great hope of why we can praise the Lord. There's something else I believe that God wants you to do, and that is to take risks for God's glory and the good of others. I don't know if you noticed in this scripture, but the disciples said, Lord, you don't want to go back through Judea. They were just trying to stone you there. And Jesus still went back. He still went back anyway. And to do God's will means there will be risk at times. There'll be risks that people won't like it. You know, Jesus was perfect and people didn't like everything he did. They wanted to stone him. Some didn't understand. They wanted to kill him. Even if you do the ultimate good, there's a risk that somebody's not going to like it. And that's okay as long as you know you're doing God's work. You don't have to have courage to do God's will. There's a lot easier ways. And it says in the scriptures, you know, wide is the path that leads to destruction. The easy way is not necessarily God's way. You won't be sent on your mission alone. I like the fact that Jesus didn't say to his disciples, yes, they did just try to stone me, so you go on ahead and see Lazarus. I'll wait here for you. No, he said, I'm going to go with you. And he talked about the daylight. We're not going to be afraid. We're going to go and do God's will. I always thought this scripture, honestly, was just a little bit strange because they said, your friend has died, and he waited two more days before he went to see him. Now, if you think the Bible's hard to understand, how many would admit that it might be hard to understand? Now, when you go out to dinner, if there's two of you, you're going to spend $30 at least, unless you go to McDonald's. And that's going up in price. You can get a study Bible for $30. And I want you to get that because you need to understand some of these scriptures. You get a heart saying like that, it's like, that's pretty cold of Jesus. He waited more days after his friend had died. Down in those study notes, it tells you, the Jews had this thought that a person's soul stayed by their side for 3 days. So when Jesus had been told it took 2 days, it says, for the messenger to get to him, he waited two more days. He waited 4 days. He wanted them to know Lazarus is really dead. He's completely dead. And I'm going to raise him to life. Okay, you're going to get some understanding like that if you will go ahead and just purchase a study Bible and say, I don't understand this. That seems weird to me. I'm going to go down and look at those notes and see what the heck's going on here, you know. Jesus wanted to show to glorify God that he is the master even over death. That he can raise Lazarus to life and that he himself would come back from the dead. We often pray, and we've been asking for prayer requests for people around for addictions and people dying unnecessarily from addictions. And every time I try to ask somebody what would bring a person to this point where they would overdose and die of an addiction, and the common theme I get from different ones is they have no hope. They have no hope. Now, if you could give them a little, if you could walk around with a little pill dispenser and say, here's some hope, take it. I'm going to give you some. You would do it. I want you to say, you've got something better than that. You've got Jesus Christ. He is the hope when there looks like there's no way out. When his friend Lazarus is completely dead, there's no way out, Jesus still is able. All through the scriptures, it talks about God being able above anything we could ask or imagine. And usually it looks worse before it gets better. We get the Israelites, and they're the slaves. They have no power, no money, but God delivers them. We get David and Goliath, the little teenager compared to the 9-foot-tall warrior. God delivers them. And we get Lazarus, Jesus' friend, completely dead, and God raises him. You have hope. I want you to soak your hope in the morning. I want you to soak in who you serve. I want to soak in that your light is going to shed light on somebody else. And then instead of just giving them a little pill dispenser, I want you to, at any opportunity, hand them a Bible promise book, hand them a Bible, say something about the Lord so you can give them some hope. If they react badly, don't worry about it. You know, some of the best believers were the worst atheists. So if somebody gives you a hard time, don't let that stop you. Because God might still be working on them. And we've seen it before. Have you seen it? I have. I told you about the lady who, at my last church, after she was mad at God, some bad things had happened. And when I saw her at another occasion, she said, "I'm never going back to church, and particularly that church that I was pastoring." About a year later, she's not only in church, she's leading the children's choir. I didn't say much. I just prayed and gave her some loving and whatever else I could do whenever I saw her, because I was in a different organization with her. The ones that say the worst, never going to happen, leave the never to God. We have hope. We have purpose from who we serve. You're going to have to start out this way, though. If you're going to be a hope dispenser, you're going to have to get a hold of God in the morning. You know, you're going to have to turn on your music. You're going to have to open up your Bible or get this Bible gateway. Dave and I have this routine now. He said he wasn't reading his Bible enough, so he gets the Bible gateway verse of the day, just sends it to your email. So at breakfast table, we always read what the scripture is. But not only that, he tries to stump me. He says, "Okay, where is it in the Bible? I have to know this before I have my coffee," you know? But, you know, you can get a Bible verse that way. You start out your day remembering you serve a mighty God. You serve a mighty God. Fill yourself up with his hope and his purpose so that when you go out, you'll give glory to God and you'll be of great help. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we pray this morning for Penny Bizov. Ask for your healing for her, Lord, and your help. Lord, we pray that we'll wake up each morning and be inspired of who we are serving, the Almighty God, the God who loves this world and who provides a way for each person to come to you. Lord, help us to be filled up with your hope, that we might give away your hope to others. We pray this in your holy name.